His own Spirit led. Though with a scornful wonder the world sees us oppressed, by schisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed, yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up, how long? But soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of our war, we wait the consummation of peace forevermore, till with a vision glorious our longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. We now on earth have union with God the three in one, and share through faith communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
The grace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
We come together to praise God, to hear the Holy Word, and to seek for ourselves and others the power, presence, and direction of the Holy Spirit. Together, let us pray. Eternal God, Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, you gave to your apostles many excellent gifts. Give dear grace to all servants of your church, that we may with diligence and faithfulness in these ministries. Grant that we, your people, may follow where you lead, perfect our ministries, and live in joyful obedience to your will. Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. We do not have water.
It's right there in that shell.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. I know. Mm-hmm. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Join with me. Ministry is the work of God, done by the people of God. Through baptism, all Christians are made part of the priesthood of all believers, the church, Christ's body, made visible in the world. We all share in Christ's ministry of love and service for the redemption of the human family and the whole of creation. Therefore, in celebration of our common ministry, I call upon all God's people gathered here. Remember your baptism and be thankful.
We remember our baptism and affirm our common ministry.
All right. Go back over and be seated.
On behalf of the laity of local congregations who have examined and approved these candidates,
and on behalf of the Board of Ordained Ministry of this annual conference, which has recommended these persons, and this annual conference, which has approved them,
we present these persons to be commissioned for the work of deacon and elder: Connor Joseph Bell, Leslie Haven Boyd, Lydia Michelle Cummings Daly, Jane Elizabeth Faisal, Hannah Holland Hutchinson, Nathan Douglas Hutchinson, Jenna Ann Johnson, Randy Jarrell Jones, Kevin Michael Kosh Jr., Michael Thomas Lindsay, Linda Little Malone, Jill Shannon Shaw, Hannah Lynn Shempert.
We present these persons to be recognized as associate members of this annual conference: Timothy Allen Atwood, Melissa Ruth Crawford, Richard Dwayne Scoggins.
We present these persons to be ordained deacons: Sandra Glenn Brown, Catherine Helen Butler, Christina Gail Crabtree, and Laura Michelle Galambos.
We present these persons to be ordained elders: Eugene Venable Bramlett Jr., Charles Andrew Collette, Michael D. Evans, Haywood Isaac Hanna, Nathan Reed Phillips, Michael John Pope, Anzette Smith Thomas, Jeffrey Paul Walton.
We present this person, whose orders will be recognized as elder: Kelvin Dwayne Mayo.
These persons are by God's grace to be commissioned, recognized, or ordained to ministry in Christ's holy church. Those authorized by the church to inquire about them have discerned that they are persons of sound learning and of Christian character, and possess the necessary signs of God's grace, and have demonstrated a profound commitment to serve Jesus Christ. Therefore, we believe them to be duly called to serve God. And so we ask you, people of God, to declare your assent to the commissioning, ordination, or recognition of these persons. Do you trust that they are worthy by God's grace to be commissioned, ordained, or recognized?
We do. Thanks be to God.
Will you uphold them in their ministries?
With God's help, we will.
God bless you.
I pray we'll find your light.
It has been such a joy to be with you in these days. I want to thank Bishop Swanson and his wonderful team for what I have experienced as holy hospitality. I thank the Mississippi Annual Conference for the great witness that you have brought in these days and the wonderful conversations that I have had that have inspired me while I have been here. Tonight our text is Philippians chapter 2, beginning with verse 19 and reading through 24. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare. For everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me, and I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. This is the word of the Lord. The year was 1920, and in the tiny town of Delight, Arkansas, Miss Bess Covington was not exactly sure how she felt about young Jess Galloway. Jess was the new preacher in town. He was single, he was handsome. And when Bess first met this young man, she was actually being pursued by another suitor. But there was something about Jess that caught her attention. Was it that he was handsome? Was it the eloquent sermons that he preached and the depth of his dedication to the ministry that appealed to her so much? Or was it simply that he had his eye on her? An important discovery for my family has been a box of yellowing love letters. They were tucked away very carefully beneath lace doilies in my grandmother's cedar chest. And the letters were written by my later-to-be grandfather, Reverend Jess Galloway of the Arkansas Annual Conference, to my later-to-be grandmother, Bess Covington. In 1920, Bess lived in Delight, Arkansas, near town with her parents. She was a teacher in the school, but in the summertime, she would help run the old dry goods store. Jess lived by himself in the parsonage. He lived near the mill, and he would travel to his churches on horseback every Sunday morning. He rode 12 miles to three different churches. So Jess and Bess were just beginning to test their feelings for one another when they started writing letters to each other every day. So you wouldn't think that was strange if Jess lived over in Murfreesboro or in Pike City or some other town. Not only did they live in the same town, they lived on the same road. But every day during the summer, Bess would watch out that dry goods store window, and she would see Jess coming down the sidewalk with one of those letters in his hand. And he would go to the post office and drop it off, and in just a little while, Bess would come out and check her mail and see if she got anything. So tonight I'd like to begin by reading for you one of those letters. May 7th, 1920, Saturday morning. My dear Bess, the beauty of last evening still hangs in the art gallery of my mental pictures. The beautiful evening with its disc of a moon hiding through the vine and your honeysuckle tree, the fragrance of the flowers and the softest breath of an early summer breeze. But the center of it all to me was one wonderful little woman who was and is fairer than the moon, whose fragrant graces and virtues are quieter than the fragrance of the flower, and whose kind heart softens and touches other hearts as tenderly as softest evening zephyrs touch flushed cheeks or drooping flowers. That was one sentence. I know that if the gates to Loveland were opened, Bess, I think we could go there for a short cultivating season, and that love would soon be in full bloom, and by its delectable hearts, our hungry hearts would be satisfied. Often I feel, while in your presence, that I am in the presence of a woman with strong, loving hands and a courageous, cheery heart, who is a heroine on the field where pure women win and in their victories call out for pure, brave, and good men, only to join hands, head, and heart for newer and greater endeavors. I thank God for such a gift, and I hope to have a chance to love a happy woman and a chance to sit at your feet and bring all of my love to the most adorable, truest, and best woman in all of sun-kissed Dixie, the home of the strongest and noblest of beautiful women. And he closes with this one sentence. Imagine that I have kissed the breeze this morning and sent it to touch with its tenderness your cheek. Your own, Jess. Tonight, we celebrate that God extended to each of you an irresistible love invitation. It was God who wooed you. It was God who won you into this covenant moment in which you find yourselves this evening. And how did that happen? How did God get your attention? How did God guide you to this time tonight where you will find yourself kneeling and entering into a lifetime covenant? Did God speak to your heart in the middle of the night? Did God speak to you in the middle of a sermon? In the middle of a conversation? Did someone else point out to you that you would have skills and gifts and calling for ministry? Did someone else get a glimpse of your calling before you did? Was it more vague? Was it hard to work out? Maybe you did not get the support you longed for from other people. I was 17 years old when my older sister announced that she felt called to become a United Methodist pastor and was going to seminary. She is 4 years older than I am. And I said to my sister this highly supportive statement, "You are so weird." That is weird. I have never heard of a girl doing that. In the early years of ministry, when the rest of us were in your shoes, we trembled a bit. And it is good to come to this moment trembling. Most of us in the ordination chair wondered, will this ministry thing go well, or will this not at all go well? And I'm very pleased to tell you tonight that I have the answer to the question. The answer is yes. There are times in ministry when the joy of it all is so powerful You know you are in the midst of something that is greater than you are, and it takes your breath away. The droplets of baptism waters upon baby hair. Your hand upon the head of a person who is kneeling and who has trusted you to pray. A confirmation candidate who comes to you and has a conversation like I had not too long ago. It went like this. I said, "So Adam, can you remember a time in your life in which you told God that you wanted to give God your whole life?" "No, ma'am, I cannot remember a time like that." I said, "Well, would you like to have a time like that? Right here in my office, right now, this afternoon?" "Well, yes, ma'am, I think I would." And for a moment, the earth stands still. It is a golden moment. It is a holy moment, and you are in it. And then there are the other times. Do you ever have butterflies in your stomach wondering if you're going to blow it? Wondering if you're going to fail? The answer is also yes. The words will come out all wrong. You will do something, you will say something that later you regret. You will handle something poorly. You will even doubt your own abilities. I do like this one sentence in one of my grandfather's letters. It's dated June 10th, 1920, and he says in this letter, "So many of them say that they enjoy my preaching that it makes me wonder if I am doing well or if they think they will help me." Sometimes things will go very wrong. I should have known that something was up when the funeral director said, "Well, I hope the cows have been fed." I was doing a graveside funeral. The entire funeral was to be at graveside. Sometimes, of course, we do the big funeral in the church, and then what happens at graveside is very short. We call it just a simple committal. But for this family, the cemetery had a great meaning. It was a family cemetery. It was on a piece of land that the family had owned for many years. The cemetery was large. Many family members had already been buried there. And the family said, "So we'd like to have the entire service there. We're bringing 150 chairs. We're bringing a keyboard and a sound system." So I got there early. We were over in the corner of the cemetery. I turned and I looked out over the land. It was quite beautiful. And oh, there on the hillside, I saw them. There were the cows. About 75, a large herd. It was just a pretty picture. And it wasn't until we began the service that the cows came to join us. First, just a few cows. But before long, the entire herd had relocated to just behind me. And it was during the opening prayer that it started. "Gracious and almighty God." "We come here today." First, just a few cows were mooing, and then many, many cows were mooing. And during the prayer, I couldn't help it. I looked up to the wife of the man who had died, and she was doing this. And so after the prayer, I said, "Well, let's sing our hymn." And the keyboard began, and so also began the full choir of cows. It was so loud, we could hardly hear ourselves sing. And then it struck me, well, maybe it's the amplification of my voice. Maybe the microphone is really loud and that's inspiring them. And so for the eulogy, I came down off of the microphone and I just said, "Come in close," and they did. And I started, it was almost a loud whisper. "So Fred Miller was born in Weatherford, Oklahoma in 1938. And the cows moved in a little closer. But they were fairly quiet. And so we made it all through the eulogy. I think everyone could hear. And came time for the closing song. We started that keyboard up again, and those cows sang with us right until the very end. And not only were we singing, but clearly some of us were uncontrollably laughing. Things will go wrong. I picked this passage of scripture tonight because of what it reveals to us about being a powerful minister of the gospel. If you will approach the years ahead of ministry with the one posture that is described in this passage, it will go well. It is humility. Paul spends much of Philippians chapter 2 saying things like, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard other people as better than yourself." And then this verse 4 that we read tonight, "Let each of you look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others." And then Paul says to the Philippians that he is sending his very best to them. He says he is sending Timothy, and he explains why Timothy is so impactful as a minister of the gospel. And this is our clue as to what makes ministry go well. Paul says, verse 20, "I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare. For everyone looks out for their interests, not those of Jesus Christ." So Paul is saying, "I am sending to you a young man who has a greater concern for his sheep than he does for himself. I am sending to you a pastor who has a greater concern for the interests of Jesus Christ than he has for the interests of himself." We are not naturally a humble people. And yet, if we want to have the kind of relationship with God and with other people that God wants us to have, then we need to come to some understanding of humility in our lives. Romans 12:3, these are the words of Paul. "We should not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think, but we ought to think of ourselves with sound judgment." In other words, humility is simply seeing the world accurately. Sound judgment. John 15 is the key. "Apart from Christ, I can do nothing, but with Christ, I can do all things." I also love that scripture. "Let the one who wants to boast, go ahead, boast in the Lord." One of the things I like about Martin Luther, the leader of the Great Reformation, is what he said about his followers. God worked through him to bring multitudes of people into faith, and the people wanted to praise Luther for what was happening. Luther kept saying, "It is not me, it is God." It was in 1521 that Christians began to get a nickname. People, even the head of the church, began to call Christians Lutherans. And Luther was horrified, and he tried to stop it. And he said, "You are not Lutherans, you are Christians. Why would you give my name to the people of Christ?" And then he said this, "I am a miserable bag of worms." So you might try that at the door. Someone comes by and says, "That was a marvelous sermon." And you could just borrow that. "I am a miserable bag of worms." He could not bear it. A.W. Tozier wrote this, "I've met two types of Christians, the proud who imagine that they are humble, and the humble who are afraid to do great things for God. I wish for a third class, the self-forgetful ones who leave the whole thing in the hands of Christ and who are so busy serving that they do not waste time trying to make themselves good or humble. They will reach humility far quicker than the rest of us. They will serve, and then they will blush when they get caught doing it." Humility is the key to all the ministry opportunities before you. Fred Craddock used to talk about how, as a kid, he had heard many sermon illustrations. He said they included the lineup of people with the stature of Albert Schweitzer, Mother Teresa, and missionaries, he said, who had had their feet frozen off in the tundra of the north. And he said that as a kid, he would listen to those stories and he would think to himself, well, to be a real Christian, somebody needs to be chasing you, persecuting you, putting you in prison, or requiring some extraordinary sacrifice from you. And he said, well, it's a shame you can't be a Christian in my little town because nobody here is chasing or imprisoning or killing anybody. And then he went to summer camp. And one night, it was very inspiring for him. It was a night of invitation around the campfire at the lake. They sang the song, "Are Ye Able?" said the master. And Fred said that he went back to his dorm room and he went down on his bunk and he said to God, "I am able and I will give my life to you." But he said that because of those childhood images, he pictured himself running in front of a train and rescuing a child. He saw himself swimming out into the ocean and rescuing a woman who was drowning. And he also pictured himself kneeling against a gray wall with his hands behind his head, and a row of soldiers held their guns ready to fire. One soldier comes to him and says, "This is your last chance to deny Christ and to live. Say you'll give it up." And he said, "I imagined myself looking that man in the face and professing my faith. And I heard the call, 'Ready, aim, and fire.' And then I saw my body slump down. The flags were put at half staff. Widows were weeping in the afternoon." He imagined a very large monument built to himself. And people would come with their cameras. And they would say, "Johnny, now you stand over there, right there next to that man who sacrificed his whole life for people. Let me get your picture." And Fred writes this, "I was sincere then, as I have been these 45 years since I gave my life to Christ. But nobody told me that I didn't have to write one big check. I could write 45 years of little checks. $5 here, $12 there, 47 cents there. Nobody told me that this giving of myself would happen in many, many continual, quiet ways all through my life. Tonight, we are ordaining and commissioning these who sit before you to go and write such checks. I do like it that in Scripture there is the expression of the emotion of God. God laughs, God is angry, God feels, there's compassion, there's empathy. So, here's what I was wondering. How do you suppose God is feeling about tonight? How do you think God felt when each one of us said yes for the first time to the invitation to have a life of love and faith in Christ? How do you think God felt when you first whispered your yes to that covenant of ministry? Does God feel a joy similar to the suitor who has won the bride he has been wooing? I want to read you my favorite of the over 100 letters that I have that were written by my grandfather Jess to my grandmother Bess. This letter was written on the morning after his proposal of marriage, June 5, 1920. "My own dear Bess, I shall never forget the evening of June the 4th, 1920. It means a new world of promise and new hopes. It means a real life and love. I will try, Bess, dear, to give to you a man who will live up to your ideas and your ambitions, a man who will be a husband who is thoughtful and kind and tender. Am I happy? I'm just radiantly joyous, that's all. And whatever rejoices you now rejoices me. And whatever burdens you or grieves you grieves me. I shall love you tenderly and dearly and will always. I want to give love for love, character for character, and go as companions together now to do God's work. And I want to be a worthy person of this altogether worthy love that you are bringing to me. I love you tenderly and dearly, and I shall always. Does God feel that way tonight? Am I happy? I'm just radiantly joyous, that's all. And now whatever rejoices you rejoices me. And whatever burdens or grieves you, grieves me. And I will love you tenderly, dearly, and will always. Amen.
Tonight, our offering goes to the Ministerial Education Fund. And this has helped tremendously with pastors and their education. And so I always ask this every year, for those that have been a benefit of that, if you would stand. Look around at all the people that have been able to go to school because of you, the church. And that's amazing to me. And y'all being be seated. And so tonight, that is what our offering goes to the future of the church, for those that they are still calling, for those that are still in seminary. I know some of those are here. And we just ask you to give, and we thank you for your support.
Let us pray. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far along the way. Right now we pause to give a portion of those things back, God, and we say thank you, God. God, whatever someone gives, whether they give, God, we want you to restore back to them some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. Let everyone know that whatever they give, they're giving on good ground. God, we say thank you, God, for the small gift or the big. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
With my eyes, I see the need for for more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free. So Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say, my storage is empty and I am available to you. So now I'm giving back to you all the tools you gave to me, my hands, my ears, my voice, my eyes, so you can use them as you please. I am lifting up this cup. Lord, would you please fill it up? Now I'm free, I just wanna be more available to you. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord, to show somebody the way and enable me to say, Lord, my storage is empty and I am available to Yes, I am. Hey, my storage is empty, and I am available to you. My storage is empty, Lord.
Bless you.
My
sisters and brothers in Christ, you have been called to associate membership, commissioned or ordained ministry. The church now confirms your calling.
As associate members, commissioned or ordained ministers, you are to be co-workers with the laity, bishops, deacons, diaconal ministers, deaconesses, home missioners, commissioned ministers, local pastors and elders. Remember, you are called to serve rather than be served, to proclaim the faith of the church and no other, to look after the concerns of God above all, so that we may know that you believe yourselves to be called by God and that you profess the Christian faith. We ask you,
do you believe that God has called you to the life and work of ordained ministry? Do you believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Are you persuaded that the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments contain all things necessary for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ and are the unique and authoritative standard for the church's faith and life?
I am so persuaded by God's grace.
Will you be faithful in prayer, in the study of the Holy Scriptures, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, continually rekindle the gift of God that is in you?
I will, with the help of God.
Will you do your best to pattern your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ?
I will, with the help of God.
Will you, in the exercise of your ministry, lead the people of God to faith in Jesus Christ, to participate in the life and work of the community, and to seek peace, justice, and freedom for all people? Will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church, accepting its order, liturgy, doctrine, and discipline, defending it against all doctrines contrary to God's holy word, and committing yourself to be accountable with those serving with you, and to the bishop, and those who are appointed to supervise your ministry?
May God, who has given you the will to do these things, give you the grace to perform them, that the work begun in you may be brought to perfection. Amen.
One who is not able to be with them. Hannah Schimpert, who is a member of their commissioning class, is expecting and was unable to travel to be here in this holy moment. We invite you to remember her in your prayers, and we also rejoice that she has joined us through technology, and Hannah is with us tonight. At some time later, the bishop will be traveling and to perform her commissioning within her church ministry and her church family. But we are grateful that Hannah is with us.
By affirming the covenant of baptism, all members of Christ's holy church pledge to serve as Christ's representatives in the world. Christ gave all of us this command: ask the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into his harvest. We've asked, and the Lord has answered. These sisters and brothers know our Savior's concern for God's people, see the plentiful harvest, and are ready to respond generously to the Lord in the words of the prophet, "Here I am, send me." Urged on by the love of Christ and strengthened by the Holy Spirit, they now come to declare in public their desire to live out of the covenant made at their baptism by binding themselves to the service of God under the supervision of the bishop and the guidance of ordained colleagues, and by being appointed to share as servant leaders in the body of Christ. This evening, we commission them to service as they continue to prepare for ordained ministry among us. Let us pray. God of the apostles and prophets, of the martyrs and teachers, you raise up men and women to be our apostolic leaders in your church. By your Holy Spirit, help these, your servants, to understand and live the mystery of your love with boldness and joy. Deepen their sense of purpose as they exercise commissioned ministry. Empower them and those who will walk with them to guide their ministry, together with all of your people, to heal the sick, love the outcast, resist evil, preach the word, and give themselves freely for your name's sake. Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Connor Joseph Bell. Send him now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Leslie Haven Board. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Lydia Michelle Cummings Daly. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Jane Elizabeth Faisal. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Hannah Holland Hutchinson. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Nathan Douglas Hutchinson. Send him now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Jenna Ann Johnson. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, Pour out your Holy Spirit upon Randy Gerald Jones. Send him now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Kevin Michael Koch Jr. Send him now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Linda Little Malone. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Jill Shannon Shaw. Send her now to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon Michael Thomas Lindsay. Send him now to proclaim your good news of Jesus Christ, to announce the reign of God, and to equip the church for ministry in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
after the music. Even though they're up in there, I'll go on and address them.
These are the three right here. Your three associate members are right here.
After fulfillment of all the requirements and after due examination of your call in ministry, we now welcome you as associate members of this annual conference. You have given assurance of your faith and Christian experience. You have committed yourself to uphold faithfully the United Methodist Church and to the work of a pastor under appointment of the bishop. We rejoice that you've been called to serve among us and pray that God may guide your ministry.
Almighty God. Bless Timothy Allen Atwood for the office and work of an associate member, to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people to serve the word. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
amen.
Almighty God, bless Melissa Ruth Crawford for the office and work of an associate member to proclaim the word of God and to hear and to lead God's people to serve the world. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
amen.
Almighty God, bless Richard Dwayne Scroggins for the office and work of an associate member to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people to serve the world. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
deacons are supposed to be coming for. A deacon is called to share in Christ's ministry of servanthood, to relate to the life of the community in its service in the world, to lead others into Christian discipleship, to nurture disciples for witness and service. A deacon is also called to lead in worship, to teach and proclaim God's word, to assist the elders and the local pastors at holy baptism and Holy Communion, to interpret to the church the world's hurts and hopes, to serve all people, particularly the poor, the sick, and the oppressed, and to lead Christ's people in ministries of compassion and justice, liberation and reconciliation, even in the face of hardship and personal sacrifice. These are the duties of a deacon.
Almighty God, pour upon Sandra Glenn Brown the Holy Spirit for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
amen.
Sandra Glenn Brown, take authority as a deacon to proclaim the word of God and to preach that word to God's people and to serve them and to serve in this world. In the name of the Father and in the name of the Son and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
amen.
Almighty God, pour upon Catherine Helen Butler the Holy Spirit for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
Amen. Amen.
Catherine Helen Butler, take the authority as a deacon to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people to serve in the world. In the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
This is yours. Let's go. Ready? This is yours. Almighty God, pour upon Christina Gail Crabtree the Holy Spirit for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's holy church. And the people of God all said,
Amen. Amen.
Christina Gail Crabtree, take authority as a deacon to preach the word of God and to lead God's people to serve the world in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And the people all said,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour upon Laura Michelle Galambos the Holy Spirit for the office and work of a deacon in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
Amen. Amen.
Place your hand. Laura Michelle Galambos, take authority as a deacon to proclaim the word of God and to lead God's people. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Let the church say,
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
An elder is called to share in the ministry of Christ and of the whole church, to preach and teach the word of God, and faithfully administer the sacraments of holy baptism and holy communion. To lead the people of God in worship and prayer, to lead persons to faith in Jesus Christ, to exercise pastoral supervision, order of the life of the congregation, counsel the troubled, and declare forgiveness of sin. To lead the people of God in obedience to Christ's mission in the world, to seek justice, peace, and freedom for all people, and to take a responsible place in the government of the church and in service in and to the community. These are the duties of an elder.
Do you believe that God has called you to the life and work of an elder?
I do so believe.
Will you, for the sake of the church's life and mission, covenant to participate in the order of elders? Will you give yourself to God through the order of elders in order to sustain and build each other up in prayer, study, worship, and service?
I will, with the help of God and the help of my sisters and brothers in the order of elders.
As these persons are recognized and ordained by God and the church for the ministry of elders to which they believe they have been called by the Holy Spirit, let us pray for them. We praise you, eternal God, because you have called us to be a priestly people, offering to you acceptable worship through Jesus Christ, our Lord, apostle and high priest, shepherd and bishop of our souls. We thank you that by dying, Christ has overcome death, and having ascended into heaven, has poured forth gifts abundantly on your people, making some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, to build up Christ's body, and to fulfill your gracious purpose in the world. Give to these your servants the grace and power they need to serve you in this ministry. Make them faithful pastors, patient teachers, wide counselors. Enable them to serve without reproach, to proclaim the gospel of salvation, to administer the sacrament of the new covenant, and to offer with all your people spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Almighty God, pour upon Eugene and Venerable Bramlett Jr. the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
Amen.
Thank you. Eugene, Venerable Bramlett Jr., take authority as an elder to preach the word of God, to administer the holy sacraments, and to lead a life in this church administering the holy sacraments, and leading the people of God. Do so in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And let the people of God all say,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour upon Charles Andrew Collette the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people all said, Amen. Charles Andrew Collette, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments and to order the life of this God's holy church in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And let the people of God all say,
Amen.
Almighty God, pour upon Michael Duane Evans the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people of God all said,
Amen. Amen.
Michael Duane Evans, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments and to order the life of the church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the people all said,
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Almighty God, pour upon Heywood Isaac Hannah the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church, and the people of God all said,
Amen.
Heywood Isaac Hannah, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments and to order the life of the church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the people all said,
Amen.
Amen. Almighty God, pour upon Nathan Reed Phillips the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
Amen.
Nathan Reed Phillips, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments and order the life of the church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, pour upon Michael John Pope the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people all said,
Amen. Amen.
Michael John Pope, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God and to administer the holy sacraments and order the life of the church in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And the church all said,
Amen.
Thank you. Almighty God, pour upon Anzette Smith Thomas the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people of God all said,
Amen.
Anzette Smith Thomas, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God, to administer the holy sacraments, and to order the life of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
Amen. Amen.
Stand up and turn to your left.
Okay, we on the left.
Audible on
you. Oh, you sure did. I figured it would come.
Couldn't figure that out.
Almighty God, pour upon Jeffrey Paul Walton the Holy Spirit for the office and work of an elder in Christ's holy church. And the people of God all said,
Amen.
Amen.
Jeffrey Paul Walton, take authority as an elder to preach the word of God, to administer the holy sacraments, and to order the life of the church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And the people of God all said,
Amen. Amen.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Kevin Duane Mayo, after due examination of your call and ministry in another part of Christ's Holy Church, we now welcome you into this communion. You have given assurance of your faith and Christian experience, and you have renewed the vows of your ordination and committed yourself to uphold faithfully the vows within the United Methodist Church. We rejoice that you have been called to serve among us and pray that God may guide your ministry. Therefore, Kevin Duane Mayo, we recognize you today as an elder in the United Methodist Church. Welcome into the Mississippi Annual Conference. Amen. Learning how to wear a robe. God bless you.
Thank you.
Special welcome to Kevin Duane Mayo. Amen. Over and over in Scripture, we see one generation of leaders authorize another generation, conveying the responsibility for leading God's people to those who come after them. Moses mentored Joshua, Naomi mentored Ruth, Elijah passed the mantle unto Elisha, Priscilla and Aquila befriended Paul. Paul encouraged Timothy and others to be faithful to the task they were given. And therefore, at Temple, I ask you to receive this stole as a sign of our life in Christ's ministry together and to also pass it on.
We have received the light of Christ in our ministries and in our lives. Now, we share the light with you. Tend the light that is given you. We pray that the light of Christ will shine in and through you and your ministries. Reverend Haywood Hanna, I share this stole with you, offering the support and prayers of our generation.
We who come after you receive this gift with gratitude. May your faithfulness encourage us patiently to walk in the light that is given us through the laying on of hands, that we may shine with the spirit of power, of love, and self-discipline.
I praise God from whom all blessings flow. And so the gifts of one generation are handed down to the next. These faithful retiring servants have marched in the light of Christ and now
send forward a new community of associate, commissioned, and ordained servants to lead us forward in the march of Christ.
Let us pray. We thank you, gracious God, for raising up among us faithful servants. Clothe them with your righteousness, and grant that we, with them, may glorify you by giving ourselves to others. Amen.
Some 4 to 5 years ago, we established a sort of, not even old enough to be called a tradition yet, but a ritual here within the Mississippi Conference, a way of life, let me put it that way. You just saw the passing of the mantle from one generation of ministers to another generation of ministers. And what we've decided to do is that this service is always so moving that oftentimes there are people who come to witness the ordination, commissioning, and the making of associate members, that in this service, people hear the call to be the next generation, literally, hear the call of God upon their lives. And we don't want something to come along and snatch away that call from their lives. And so at the end of this service, we always, at this point in the service, we always extend a call. And so I'm going to ask our district superintendents, district lay leaders, if they would come forward, they're here, stand with them. And we will sing the song. And while we're singing, if there are those of you who have been touched by what you have seen here tonight and want to respond to what you are hearing, and that is God may be calling you to be a part of a call to ministry like you see from these persons here, this is a good time for you to do it. Just one quick story. Years ago, I was doing an ordination service. A young lady came with her grandfather. She was a teenager. She just came with granddaddy for that summer. She had never seen a woman ordained for ministry in her life. And after the ordination service, she walked up to me. And she said, I didn't know you do that. I said, you didn't know I do what? She said, I didn't know church ordained women. I said, oh, yeah. I said, we're United Methodist. We've been doing that. At that time, we were really celebrating our 50th anniversary of the ordination of women. And she said, I just didn't know it. And she just ran on off. 2 years later, she returned to tell me she had accepted her call to ministry. We don't know what may be stirring inside of you. We don't know what's going on. Maybe some of you may have also heard a call a long time ago, but you've just been delaying it. This is an opportunity. Come and respond with men and women who understand what it's like to hear the tug and the whisper of God on your heart. So as we sing this song, feel free, if God is calling you, feel free to come. Just feel free to come. Just feel free to come. Feel free. Feel free. Feel free to respond to the promptings and leading of the Holy Spirit.
Oh,
So much for coming and witnessing this ordination, commissioning, and opportunity for the associate members to be welcomed into the life of the church as ministers of the gospel. One of the blessed parts of being a part of the United Methodist Church. And I'm trying to get this just right in my mind, but I think I'm right. There's a part of the dismissal that I thought was you should allow deacons to do. Somebody who knows that better than me will tell me, and they will correct me somewhere down the line on it. Amen. But I'm going to ask one of these new deacons to do that, and then I'll give the benediction. Or if it's either reverse, we'll figure it out later on. But I know a deacon is supposed to assist the elder at that point. And so I want to start them off right. Get them over their shyness. Amen. And so we're going to do that, ask you to do the blessing, and then I'll do a benediction. And elders and deacons and associate members, I know when these come down, amen, we're going to recess. Is that what we're going to do? Oh, no recessing. Okay. When they come down, mob them. Amen. And welcome them into the elders' orders, the deacons' orders, and associate members association. Okay.
May we receive the blessing of the deep love of the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the deep moving wind and fire of our Holy Spirit going forth from here. Ready to make disciples for the transformation of the world. Amen.
And now may the blessings of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you henceforth, now, and forevermore. Go from this place in joy. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Congratulations. 1, 2, 3.